Good morning. How's everybody doing today? So, if you are visiting with us today, and this is your first time here, you're about to see what we don't normally do. We have this is the best way I've explained today's sermon to people, is if you ever watch a TV show, and they throw a random musical in the middle of the TV show, that's what you're getting today at the Crossings Church, is that one random musical episode that's what is going on? Because normally what we would do at the Crossings is we'd sing that song, and then we would have somebody come up and just kind of welcome you to the Crossings Church, and then we'd give you guys a minute or two to kind of greet people next to you, and then we'd sing another song, and then we would have another couple songs, and then we would jump into our service, and then we'd finish up with a few songs. But we're in the middle of a sermon series that's all about worship. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to kind of infuse our songs into our sermon today. And we're going to talk a lot about different samples, I would say, of types of songs that we should be singing for God. So just to start off, since we didn't get to say hi, without getting out of your seat, you guys want to kind of turn from people side to side and just kind of wave and let people know that you're glad that they're here today. We do have a lot of new faces here today, which is really awesome. We have a lot of new faces here today, which is really awesome. And so you guys have picked an awesome church to just kind of visit and check out. I'm not normally even the normal person up here as well. So this is a complete, if this is your first time here, this is not what you're going to see every single Sunday. I'm the campus minister here at the Crossings Church. And I'm getting put in rotations to preach a little bit from time to time throughout the months. And so this just so happens to be the week that I'm up here on stage. And so we're in the middle of a sermon series that's all about worship, and it's called Y-Tunes. And if you can see what we did there, we kind of took the iTunes and made a Y out of it. I thought it was so clever. but we've taken this idea of Y-Tunes and just talked about why do we sing? Why is it so important to sing to God? And when you think about that, if you would just ask that normal random question to somebody and you say, Why do we sing? Most answers would be to worship God, to show God that you love him and to show worship. Well, then when you ask that question, okay, well, why do we worship then? Why is it that we need to worship God? Well, to show him that we love him, to show him that it's something that he needs from us, to see. Well, in your notes on Acts 17, 24 and 25, it says, God is the creator of all things. He doesn't lack a thing that we mortals could supply for him. For he has all things and everything he needs. So you read this verse and well, then it can't be for God, because it says here that God already had, there's nothing that we can give him that he's oh yes, finally I got exactly what I need. God's I don't need anything from you guys. I got everything that I need. So then why is it that we still need to sing? Why is it that we need to worship? Why is it that the Bible commands us? It's not that it's just if you like to sing or if you have a good voice that you should sing, but God literally says in the scriptures he commands us to sing to him, to give praise to him, to worship him. So why is it then that we need to do that if he doesn't need it? Well, there's only one other answer. If God doesn't need it but he commands it, then it must mean that we need it. It must mean that worship is to help us, to work with us. And over the last few weeks, we've kind of talked about a little bit of worship in general, and what doesn't make my song a top hit. We talked a lot about top hits and top music throughout the country, and what makes those hits so great. But when you look at God, there are certain things that don't make a good song, and there's things that he doesn't care about. And so we talked about these last few weeks, and one of them was the tune. God doesn't care about the tune. He doesn't care about the beat. He doesn't care about the percussion side of it. He doesn't care about those kind of things. That's not really what God cares about. Whenever you think about a lot of the songs, and people are like, I just listen to rap music because of the beat. And I'm like, well, good, because if you listen to it for the words, then you probably wouldn't be a Christian. Because some of the stuff that you listen to is rough, and some people are like, I just listen to it because of the solos. I just listen to it because of the certain instrument that's put into it, and it makes you just sound well. And as a disciple, you look at that stuff, you're like, well, God must not just be concerned about the beat, because he wants to know what you're singing, why you're singing what you're singing. He's not so concerned about the beat. So it's not the tune that makes a song a good song. It's not the talent that makes a song a good song, which is fortunate for me, because I'm not a good singer. And anybody that knows me knows I'm not a good singer. And there's actually a running joke in our campus ministry that people know that I'm not a good singer. So when we baptize people here at the Crossings Church, we tend to sing a song after that baptism. And one just so happened one week, I didn't have anybody around me that was musically talented or inclined. So I was the man, and I stepped up, and I started the song. And it was definitely known that I was the one who started the song, because everybody was like... And so now every single time somebody gets baptized in our ministry and I'm there, they're like, Jake, why don't you start the song this week? And I'm like, no, let's have J-Tone or Lalo or my wife or literally anybody else start this song, because we know that it's not going to sound good if it's coming out of my mouth. But luckily for me, that's not what makes a good song for God. You know, luckily for me, God says, I don't care what you sound like. I don't care how talented you are, because it's about your heart. It's about a joyful noise that comes from you. And if you have joy in your heart and you're singing a song, it could be a cat scratch on a chalkboard, and it's going to be what God wants it to be. So it's not the tune, it's not the talent, it's not the timing. You know, it's not the cadence of the song, it's not how it's orchestrated, it's not how it's put together. It's not just like this awesome composed, you know, just how it flows well, and there's highs and lows in the song. Like, it's not the timing. And lastly, it's not the type. It's not the type of song. It's not country or R&B or whatever, because a song that means something to God is not just in a certain genre. It can be any of those. So it's not just about a certain type. So then if it's not about those things that makes it a hit for God, what is it that makes it a hit for God? Well, I don't think this is on your notes because we're reviewing this, but in Colossians 3:16, it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. And as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts towards God. And that's what makes a song a hit song for God. We talked about that last week. It communicates truth. It connects me to others. It comes from the heart, and it centers on God. And that's what God wants us to understand worship should look like and what it should be like. And so in Romans 15:4, and this is on your notes, it says, even if it was written in Scripture long ago, it was written for us. And so today we're going to talk about Psalms. We're going to talk about the actual book of Psalms in the Bible. And I think a lot of times we overlook the book of Psalms. Or we look at it for like advice, you know, kind of like Proverbs a little bit. Like we'll go back and we'll refer to it. But we really don't dig in and digest Psalms, I think, the way that God has intended us to. Or the way that David wrote it and communicated it for us to understand. In 1 Corinthians 10:11, it says, all these things happen for a reason, to sound a warning. They were written down and passed down to us to teach us. They were meant especially for us. And so that means that there's something in the book Psalms that is meant for you. There's something written in there that is meant to communicate something to you, to reside in you, to have a parallel that you guys can understand and that I can understand and that I can look at and relate to the struggle or the joy or the happiness or the anger or whatever it may be that David was trying to communicate in those songs. You know, John Calvin actually had this quote, and there's a lot of things in his theology that I don't necessarily agree with, but whenever he makes this statement, I do agree with this. It says, the Psalms are anatomy of all parts of the soul. And he says, these Psalms are written down. It's the DNA for our soul. It's what makes us disciples. It's what makes the relationship that I have with God so true. It's the way that I can communicate with God, that the anatomy of all the parts of the soul come through all of these Psalms that David wrote. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about five different types of Psalms and why God wants us to sing them. Because sometimes when we come to church and we hear songs, we think that it's all about, you know, the joy or the worship or the positive stuff. And it should leave a good feeling in us as we walk out the door. The happy clappy songs, the upbeat songs and things like that. But when you start to read through the book of Psalms and you start to actually look through all these different things that David was writing, you start to realize that he was a normal dude just like all of us. And if you know David's life, you know that David had highs and lows. You know, David was an insecure little boy at a time. Well, I'm sure we've all struggled with insecurity. David defeated Goliath, you know. I don't know if a lot of us could relate to that, you know, but like there is huge highs. There's huge victories in David's life. David struggled with sin with Bathsheba. I'm sure we've all struggled with sin in our lives. You know, David was upset at times. David was happy at times. And David takes the book of Psalms and puts his life into words and sings that to God. And he wants us to understand that's why we should sing as well. We should put things into words when we praise God as well. And so what we're going to do is we're going to talk about these five different things. And as we walk through these five different things, we're actually going to pause and we're going to sing a song together that's based on one of those psalms and one of those feelings. So the first one is that God wants me to sing psalms of praise. God wants me to sing psalms of praise. And when you hear this, when you're like, okay, well, that's a no-brainer, right? That one's a pretty obvious one that God would want me to sing psalms of praise. But it says in Psalm 63, 1 through 5, and then it kind of recaps in 7, it says, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there's no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary and behold your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I'll be fully satisfied, as with the richest of foods, with singing my lips. My mouth will praise you. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings." And so what he's saying here is, I want God to know that I'm praising him. I want him to know how good it is that he is in my life. And here's why: because I'm controlled by the things I treasure. And what he's saying is I need to sing psalms of praise because wherever my heart is, that's what I'm going to praise. You know, I was thinking about this SNL skit the other day, and they're talking about, have you guys ever seen the Andy Samberg dress up like Nicolas Cage? And it's like in the cage with Nicolas Cage, and it's this whole SNL skit. And they're always like talking and they brag and everything, and right? And at the end of it, there's always this scene where anytime that Nicolas Cage or Andy Samberg gets a compliment, he goes, "That's how I praise," you know? And he just goes on. And one time they had Nicolas Cage show up on the show with Andy Samberg acting like Nicolas Cage, and just went back and forth like, "That's how I praise. That's how I praise." And they just went back and forth. But the things they were talking about, when you think of the word praise, you think of a religious term. But literally anything that you brag about, anything in your life that's good, anything that's constantly on your mind and in your heart, you praise it. That's praise. That's what praise is. And so what he's trying to understand or get us to understand is David saying, anything that you treasure, you're going to praise. Matthew 7, 19 through 24 says, "Stop storing up treasures for yourselves on earth. Instead, store up treasures for yourselves in heaven. Your heart will be where your treasure is. No one can serve two masters. He will hate the first master and love the second, or he will be devoted to the first and despise the second." And so it's so imperative that we choose to worship God and we choose to sing songs of praise, because if we don't, our hearts will praise something else. The things that you talk about, the things that you sing about, the things that you involve yourselves in, if it's not centered on God, your hearts are praising something else on this earth. It could be a sport. It could be a hobby. It could be a relationship. It could be a job. It could be whatever. Think about your dialogue throughout the week. What is always on your mind? What are you always talking about? What controls you? Because those are the things that you truly praise. And what David's trying to get us to understand is this: listen, we need to sing songs of praise. I need God. Earnestly, I seek you. I thirst for you. My heart longs for you. He's singing these songs to God to let him know, listen, my heart is with you. It's not with anything else on this earth. And then that key verse says, your love is better than life. He says, your love for me is better than life. Which what he's saying is I would rather be dead than not have your love. And so he sings the song of praise. And it's kind of cool because we've actually found a song. There's an old hymnal called Your Love is Better Than Life. And it literally is Psalm 63. And so the worship is going to come up. We're going to sing that song. And when we sing a song, I want you guys to stand up and kind of sing it with them. But just, you know, think of the words. Think of what's being said. Think of the lyrics, not the beat, not the background. But think of these words that are being sung. And as you sing with them, think about the praise that God is asking you to have within that. All right? So worship team, why don't you guys come on up and we'll sing this song.
In a dry and weary land where is no water, my soul is thirsting for you. I have seen you in the sanctuary, beheld your power and glory. My lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live. In your name I will lift up my hands. Your love is better than life. Your love is better than life. Earnestly I seek you. My soul is thirsting for you, 'cause your love is better than life. Because you are my help, I will be singing in the shadow of your wings. I'm staying close beside you, your right hand upholds me. I think of you through the night. With singing lips I will praise, and my soul will be satisfied. Your love is better than life. Your love is better than life. I seek you. My soul is thirsting for you, 'cause your love is better than life. Oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I'm longing for you.
Oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I'm longing for your love is better than life. Your love is better than life. Earnestly I seek you. My soul is thirsting for you, 'cause your love is better than life. Your love is better than life.
So God wants me to sing songs, psalms of praise. And real quick, our worship team learned that song in a half hour today, and it sounds awesome. So I love that our worship team can take a song like that and just turn into something so beautiful in such short notice. And it's just so cool to see what God can do whenever you're really truly trying to find the words to sing to him. And so not only does God want me to sing songs of praise, but God wants me to sing psalms of lament. And you know, there are some words in some of these things that we're going to be talking about today. So these sermon notes came to me from another preacher. And I'm a PE major, and I don't know, like, certain words. So I actually looked this word up because I was like, what is lament? And there's another word that we're going to get to in a little bit, too, that probably a lot of you guys probably don't know either. But I was like, what the heck does this word mean? And I didn't understand what lament was. But when you think of the word lament, it literally just means sadness. And you're like, oh, yeah, let's find a good beat to that kind of thought process, right? Let's find a good backdrop for that. But lament is sadness. And David says you need to sing songs about sadness. It's okay to be sad when you're talking to God. And he wants us to know that there are psalms of lament, that, and there's a reason why we need to sing psalms of lament. And it says in Psalms 13, it says, for the worship leader, a song of David. It says, how long, O eternal one, how long will you forget me? Forever? How long will you look the other way? How long must I agonize, grieving your absence in my heart every day? How long will you let your enemies win? Turn back, Respond to me, O Eternal, my true God. Put the spark of life in my eyes, or I'm dead. And when you read that, you're like, man, he's in a bad place right now. He's in a rough spot. And when we have these songs of lament, and we think about the sadness that should show up in these songs, what Dave is trying to get us to understand is that we need to talk to God in the lowest of lows. We need to have that communication because God wants me to know that he still cares. You see, a lot of times people come to church and they hear songs and they feel like that this is, you know, this is a good feeling and whatever. But a lot of times we don't show up to church feeling good, do we? Based on the week that we just had or the situation that just showed up in our lives, or the tragedy or the hardships that we've had to walk through. We don't always walk in wanting to sing the upbeat, happy, clappy songs because there's something going on in our lives that is just hard to kind of work through. There's a sadness that shows up in our lives. And it was no different with David. And he says, I need to communicate to God that I'm just tired. I'm exhausted. That my life is in a bad place right now, and I don't like it. And what's going on? Like, how long are you going to let your enemies crush me? Like, how? He says all this different stuff. He's like, how long do I have to be in this place? And I think sometimes we feel like we can only sing to God in the good times because he doesn't want to hear us when we're sad. You know, that there's something that goes on in our heads that like, well, maybe I'm upset with God, or maybe there's this feeling towards God that doesn't just feel right. I don't feel the good self that I usually have with God, so I probably shouldn't sing to him if I'm feeling this way. And David lets us know, like, no, that's when you need to talk to God. That's when you need to let him know you need to communicate, because when we stop praising God and we stop singing songs in that sadness, sometimes we get into our minds that God doesn't really care the state of mind that we're in. That God's okay with where we're at, and that he doesn't care anymore. But it says in 1 Peter 5:7, it says, throw the whole weight of your anxieties upon him, for you are his personal concern. And so in the midst of all this sadness and all this tragedy and all these things that happen in our lives, God wants us to understand, you're going to be sad in this life. You're not going to be happy 24/7. You're not going to feel joy every single day of your life. Look at David's life. There was plenty of moments whenever he just messed up and he was put in a bad state of mind. And in the midst of all those things, he still comes to God in that sadness and lets him know, because he needs to know that God still cares. We don't just sing to God to let him know, hey, God, I'm sad. But we also sing to God to let him know, God, I'm sad, and I need to know you still care about that. I need to know that you're still here with me by my side in the midst of the sadness. You know, sometimes we'll pray for God to take away that sadness, but as a disciple, you should know that God doesn't always just take it away. So we've learned to pray for God to help us through the sadness, to be by our side through the sadness. The Bible makes it clear that we're going to have hardships in this world. He doesn't take away those hardships, but he's by us in those hardships. And when we sing songs of lament, it helps us understand, like, God, I'm in a rough patch in my life right now. And so we found this song called Warn. And it's kind of cool how the song was found, but the situation that circulated around the song was not cool. So the song Warn that we had found as a worship ministry was actually found by a worship leader at a church that we partner with in Wentzville. His name is RJ. And RJ found the song shortly after his dad had passed away. And RJ's dad was not a disciple for a very, very long time. Most of RJ's adult life, his dad was not a disciple. But then RJ was able to lead his dad to Christ. And RJ was able to baptize his dad, and his dad he became one of those people in the church that you know, and he helped and served in the kids ministry for so long in the time that he was able to be there. But RJ's dad went in for a procedure in the hospital, and it was meant to be just an overnight procedure, and he ended up not coming back out. And so it wasn't like it was seen and it was known that it was coming, but his dad suddenly was taken from him. And then the song was found. And any time that you would ever watch artists sing the song, he would tear up. Because what the song helps explain is the words in the song talk about how tired we are and how worn we are as Christians. Because it gets exhausting, right? It gets exhausting trying to do the right thing, and yet the world keeps spitting things back at you. But then there's this other side that things that you just don't understand happen. And the song helps us explain, like, just how tired and how worn we are. And we took the song, and after each verse, it ends up saying, I'm worn, I'm worn. But the Crossings changed the end of that song to say, I'm yours. Because what David wants us to understand is we need to go to God when we're sad, but not just to help him understand that we're sad, but help him also to understand that we're still his. You know? And that's the whole point of Songs of Lament, is to express our sadness to God for what's going on in our lives, what's going on with our families, what's going on in our situations. But more importantly, it's to express in the midst of that a feeling of still devotion to God. Despite the sadness that I have, you need to know how sad I am, but also that I'm still yours. So our worship team is going to come up again, and we're going to stand and sing the song Worn.
I'm tired, I'm worn, my heart is heavy from the work it takes to keep on breathing. I've made mistakes, I've let my hope fail, my soul feels crushed by the weight of this world, and I know that you can give me rest. Struggle ends, that you can mend a heart that's frail and torn. I want to know a song can rise from the ashes of a broken life, and all that's dead inside can be reborn. 'Cause I'm a just won't let up, and I know that you can give me rest. So I cry out with all that I have left. Let me see redemption win. Let me know the struggle ends, that you can mend a heart that's frail and torn. I wanna know a song can rise from ashes of a broken life, and all that's dead inside can be reborn. 'Cause I'm worn, and my prayers are wearing thin. Yeah, I'm worn, even before the day begins. Yeah, I'm worn, I've lost my will to fight. Yeah, I'm worn. So heaven come and flood my eyes. Let me see redemption win. Let me know the struggle ends, that you can mend a heart that's frail and torn. I want to know a song can rise from the ashes of a broken life, and all that's dead inside can be reborn. Let me see redemption win. Let me know the struggle ends, that you can mend a heart that's frail and torn. I want to know a song can rise from the ashes of a broken life, and all that's dead inside can be reborn. 'Cause It's all that's dead inside can be reborn. 'Cause I'm yours.
It's hard to sing that song without getting a little emotional, right? For a lot of us, that song rings so true with what's going on in the world today, or what's going on in our families, what's going on in our own backyards. And so it makes sense to have an emotional connection to songs like that. And as I look around now, I sit in the front, but when I turn around, I see a lot of people doing this, you know, right now. And that's what songs of lament are intended to do. Says, heaven, flood my eyes. Give me an emotional connection to the sadness that I'm having so I can form a deeper connection with you. And that's what God wants us to do in Songs of Lament, is to form in that intimate, caring connection with him through realizing that he can still be by our side. So not only does God want us to sing songs of praise and lament, but God also wants us to sing songs of remembrance. God wants me to sing psalms of remembrance. And it says in Psalms 136, it says, give thanks to the greatest God of all. His faithful love continues forever. By his understanding, he made the heavens. His faithful love continues forever. He spread out the earth on the waters. And then you start to see some dots, right, on your notes after each verse. He made the lights, dot, dot, dot. He made the sun, dot, dot, dot. Well, if you actually go to Psalms 136, every single verse ends with his faithful love continues forever. So when you see those dots, it says he made the great lights. His faithful love continues forever. He made the sun. His faithful love continues forever. He made the moon and stars. And it goes on. His faithful love continues forever. Give thanks to the one who killed the oldest son of each family in Egypt. He brought the people of Israel out of Egypt. Give thanks to the Lord because he is good. His faithful love continues forever. And so this whole psalm is helping us understand that we need to have a remembrance for what God has done in our lives. And David is recollecting what God has done for God's people over the span of eternity. He made the sun, you know, he made the great lights. He brought people out of Egypt. You know, he did all these different things. We need to remember these things. And we don't just remember these things because God wants us to remember these things and give thanks, but we remember these things because remembering his faithfulness helps me remain faithful. Remembering what God has done and what he's brought us through helps us remain faithful. You know, because the odd thing about a relationship with God compared to, you know, just human nature is as we get older, scientifically, we forget things. You know, if you've ever been around an old person, and they're like, "Where are my glasses?" and you're like, "They're on your head, Grandma." And you're like, "Oh, I forgot that they were up there." You know, like, and you start to see that there's just little things that it's funny because like some of you college kids, I've even heard you guys do that before. Like, they're on your head right now. You know, but as we get older, we tend to forget things. And the thing about God, though, in a relationship with God, he says, "Listen. As you get older, you cannot forget things because you are intended to remember these things so you can finish stronger." And so it's backwards in a relationship with God because there's a reason and a need to remember our past so that we don't just finish forgetting, but we finish at our strongest points remembering the highest of highs and the lowest of lows, what God's brought us through. It says in Psalm 63:7-8, it says, "You've been my help in the shadow of your wings. I will sing joyfully. My soul clings to you. Your right hand supports me." And just this idea that we're called to remember what God has done in our lives. Because as a disciple, you know, and as a Christian, you start to forget things. At least I do. You know, I've been a Christian since 2009 or so. And I look back at my life, and I had a pretty messed up background. It wasn't as bad as some people's, but for me, I grew up without a dad. And I grew up in a house with a mom and a sister, and my mom worked multiple jobs because We didn't have a dad in the house. Didn't pay child support. He wasn't around. My mom worked at a bar, and so there was a lot of shady people that came around my house. And financially, we weren't in the best place because my mom worked multiple jobs. And so it wasn't unnatural for me growing up to like have to wait up till like 1 a.m. when my mom got home with like Jack in the Box tacos for me to eat dinner, or for the power to go out, and so we did our homework by candlelight, or the heat to go out, and so we had to heat up pots of water to take baths at night. Like, that was kind of the world that I lived in as a kid, but I didn't know that it was as bad as it was when I was a kid, because as a kid, you're like, this is, you know, normal, or this is, you know, you don't talk about that stuff with other kids, so you don't know what goes on under their houses. But the main thing that I did know was different was that I didn't have a dad. I didn't know about all the power and the money and all that stuff. I didn't know people's money situations. But I did know whenever I went and I played sports that I'd watch other dads show up. And I didn't have one there. And I remember that feeling as a kid. And I remember how hard it was for me to growing up in that lifestyle. And it hurt. And all I knew is that I did not want that growing up. I didn't want my kids to have that growing up. But as you become a disciple, and I did, towards my college years, I started working on those things. And I started involving myself around a community of people, and I started getting myself in a better state of mind. And at times I forgot. I forget a lot about what God has brought me through. And so I started bickering and making selfish decisions based on things that didn't really matter in my life. You know, I started complaining about the church. Why do I have to go to this? Why do I always have to be at these things? Why is it that blah, blah, blah? And I completely forgot why I wanted to do those things in the first place. What God brought me through, what God had brought me through in so many different areas of my life. And I started to forget. And God says, listen, you need to sing songs to remember what I brought you from. You need to sing songs to remember how much your life sucked before you found me. You need to remember how much of the world you were a part of and all the regrets that you had and all the things that were broken and all the things that I came in and I fixed and I put back together for you. You need to sing songs so you don't forget that life. But the reason is so that we don't ever go back to that life. Because what God says is when you start to forget, you start to go back. Look at the Old Testament. Look what happened whenever God's people started to forget. Look what happened when they stopped teaching their kids and the next kids, and the generation started to forget. And look at what happens to the people of Israel time and time again. They get caught in sin. They forget about God. Armies come in and destroy them. Their houses and temples get just demolished. And then look what happens when they remember, you know? And God says, listen, we've got to sing songs to remember. And we need to sing songs to remember for what God has brought us through. But more importantly, we need to sing songs as to how and why God was able to bring us through those things. Because there's a side of it that it is a personal connection that God has brought us through so much. But we also forget that there wouldn't have been an opportunity for that if Jesus didn't die on the cross. And at times it's even more important that we remember that than our own past. Because when we forget about what Jesus did, we start to become very ungrateful in our lives for what we do have. We forget that there was an actual human being, an actual man, that got hung on a cross and got beaten to death for you specifically, for me specifically. We forget. And we weren't there. We weren't there at Calvary when that happened. But can you imagine how intense it would be if we were sitting here right now in a crowd and we watched a crucifixion happen right here on stage and we just watched it and you knew it was exactly for you, that you're sitting in that chair watching somebody die up here on the stage and they're back here and they're literally, they've been whipped, they've been beaten, they've been hung up on a cross, and all you can think about in your head is, that's for me. That's happening right now so I can have a different life. It'd probably be way more emotional, right? And way more intense for you to think about. But what God is trying to get us to understand is, listen, you need to sing songs because you need to connect with that somehow. Even though you weren't physically there, that happened specifically for you. And you've got to find that connection, because that is going to help you remain faithful for the rest of your life. And so we're going to sing a song here called Reckless Love. And we're also going to take communion. And the song Reckless Love is just to help exemplify the idea of how overwhelming God's love was for us. How overwhelming it always will be for us. That there's nothing that God wouldn't do for you, including having his own son hang from a cross. And we sing songs like this to help us remember not just our past and what he's brought us through, but also what Jesus did on the cross for us. So we're going to sing this song. The worship team's going to come up, and there should be some communion things next to you. They don't taste very good. I'll be honest. These are vintage from the actual first century. that's what they taste like. So we want to bring you guys, quality. But due to the COVID and the quarantine, this is kind of what we've had to resort to for now. But we want you guys to be able to take the Lord's Supper just like they did in the first century, because this is their opportunity to remember. When Jesus was sitting around with his 12, they had no idea what was about to happen. But he shared that meal, and he said, here, take this bread, this is my body. Take this juice, this wine, this is my blood. And I want you to eat this in remembrance of me. I want you to do this to remember me. And they have no idea what he was saying in that moment. But soon enough they did. And that's why, we weekly take that now. It's the same reason that Jesus had his disciples take it, so we can remember what God did for us and what Jesus did for us on the cross. So we're going to sing that song. The worship is going to come up, and we're going to take communion as well.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Only chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me.
Amen. That song is such a powerful song. And I like to believe that when he sings those words, there's no mountain you won't climb up. I believe he's talking about Golgotha, or Calvary, where Jesus climbed up to that mountain and was crucified on that cross. That there's no mountain he wouldn't climb up to come after us and to save us. And it's just a great song to just remind us how much God truly does care for us and love us. So, is that me? That interference? Alright, I'll let you guys figure it out back there. So, not only does God want to sing songs of praise, songs of lament, songs of remembrance, but God also wants me to sing songs of imprecation. And there's another word I didn't know. You know, like, I had to look this one up, imprecation. I was like, what the heck does this word mean? I was like, are there just words that I... Are they making up words for me now? Like, they're tricking me up here? And so I look up imprecation. And imprecation is literally talking about anger. And then once again, I'm like, okay, so what kind of song is this going to look like? You know, what kind of song is anger? Like, why would God want me to sing songs when I'm ticked off? And not only, like, when I'm ticked off, but he wants me to sing that the lyrics are showing that I'm ticked off. Like, I'm so mad, God, I'm so mad. You know, like, that's pretty much what he's saying here is, like, the songs you need to sing are to express your anger and frustration. Check this out in Psalms 58. He says, oh God, shatter their teeth and their mouths. Break out their fangs, O Eternal One. Let them run off the waters like a flood. Let them melt like a snail that oozes along. Have you guys ever, like, do you guys know what happens when you put salt on a snail? I found out when I was like 6, and it was like the coolest thing ever. But when you put salt on a snail, it like shrivels up, and if it sits out in the sun, it totally turns into slime. And so anytime that, like, when we were just like weird little boys, when we were kids, and we'd see some snails, like, dude, man, run inside and get some salt from mom. And we'd like grab the salt, and we'd go out there and we'd get, you know, we'd sprinkle it on it. And at first, you know, it'd be like a, and it starts shriveling up, and we're like, dude, just dump truck it. And we would just, it would literally be like a mountain of salt on this thing, right? And then we would like, we'd go play baseball or something, we'd come back, and we'd kind of like wipe it away, and there was no snail. Like, it was just sludge. And as messed up of a childhood as I had, like I said, you know, that's what David is saying needs to happen to his enemies. He's literally saying, destroy my enemies. But then he goes along and says one other thing. He says, may they be like a stillborn that never catches its first breath, never sees the sun. And we talk about all this stuff, all this anger, but even a lot of us are like, I'll still draw the line somewhere. You know, like, some of this stuff is kind of rough, but like, I don't know if I can cross that line and wish that on somebody. And when I think about just the idea of the stillborn, you know, there's a lot of people in our church that have had miscarriages or situations in pregnancies that I'm like,
I would never wish that upon somebody. But David talks and he goes, no, I want that to happen to people. I want that to show up to people's lives. And so you got to ask the question, who is he talking about here? You know, who is this for? And what he's saying, he's talking to judges right now. That's the feeling, the emotion that goes behind the psalm, is that he's talking to the judges because he does not feel like they're being fair in their decision-making processes. And that people are struggling, or that people are getting, you know, they're just, it's, they're not getting treated the way they should for the way that they are living. And David is ticked about it. And this is what he wants to happen to these people. Sound familiar with the world that we live in right now? If not, have you seen social media lately? Have you seen the way that people feel about certain people on this earth? And the way that they, there's a distaste in the country right now? And the way that David communicates this, I feel like I don't see much different on social media. You know, I hate not my president. This person needs to blah, blah, blah. And they start attacking personal flaws, and people are, even with racial injustice right now, and the way that, you know, certain people are just bigots, or they just don't understand, and you're so small-minded because, you know, and you start treating people differently because you're angry at their thought process. You're angry at their stance. You're angry at the way that they choose to handle themselves in life. And David is sitting here saying, listen, this is the same kind of crap that was going on in the first century. This is the same kind of stuff that I got angry about. And in purgatory psalms, you know, just that word purgatory, it's kind of like a curse. It's another word for like a curse, to put a curse on somebody, or to use a curse towards somebody in the way that they're being handled. And these songs are meant to focus on the wicked people in the world. And those people that have wickedness in their life, these are the songs meant for them. And if we just kind of left it at that and we like sung a song, it would almost be like, okay, we're singing songs to just bash people of the world, right? And that's not why he sings these songs, but that's who they're for. But there's a reason why we need to sing these songs to God. Because asking God to avenge us takes the pressure off of us. You see, when we sing these kind of songs, these imprecatory songs to God, to show our displeasure with what's going on in the world, what's going on in our context, it takes the pressure off of us feeling like it's our job to justify the people in the world when ultimately we know it's God's. It says in Hebrews 10:30, it says, "For we know him who said, 'Vengeance is mine. I will repay,' says the Lord. And again, the Lord will judge and determine and solve and settle the cause." You see, God wants us to sing these songs to him because he doesn't want us to do something stupid ourselves. I don't know how many times I've seen a post on social media, and I'm like, and I start typing up, and I look at it, and I'm like, delete the whole thing. I can't say that. Even though I feel it and I want to say it, I'm not going to say that. Because what I would say would not be godly. What I would say would be more to put somebody in their place. What I would say would be to express my anger towards somebody else's response. And what God says is, listen, I need you to sing these praises to me vertically. Because I want you to vent to me so I can handle it. Because when you vent horizontally, you tend to end up causing more division and more harm than you should. And this is kind of a challenge, you know, in the midst of this too, that I would say for a lot of you guys that use social media as platforms to express how angry you are at the world, I would encourage you to ask yourself if the things that you are posting are hurting or helping the mission of Christ. And before you would post something on social media, I would encourage you to maybe write it down first and give it to God before you give it to people. Because when I look in the world, I look at social media, I look at the things that people are posting to just express their stances, a lot of times it's not expressing hope and healing and unity. It's expressing, this is how I feel. And there's no solution. I just want you to know how I feel. And when you post like that, who does that help? Oh, that's how you feel? Oh man, like I guess I should find a relationship with God then if that's how you, no, nobody reacts like that. They're like, oh, that's how you feel? Well, here's how I feel. And here's how I feel. And I don't like how you feel, so I'm going to post how much I don't like how you feel because of how I feel. And we just go back and forth, and we fight about things. And God says, what are you doing as a Christian? Why are you fighting about this stuff? Give it to me. And if it's wrong, I'll deal with it. And there's two ways that God does that, you know, because sometimes whenever we have these angry people and these things happen, and it's not just social media, but it's just things in general that just go unpunished or unserved. In Psalms 58:11, it says, good people really are rewarded. Yes, there is a God judging the world. And there's the other side of this, that whenever you want to vent in the way that you feel about things, it may not just be social media, but like sexual abuse, for example. There's a lot of people in this church that have been sexually abused. I know that because of a lot of different people that I've worked with in campus ministry, people who have been moved up to the adult ministry, people even in our children's ministries that come up and they talk about and they identify with this idea of sexual abuse. And that's a big hurt in the Crossings Church, because I believe it's a big hurt in the world, but not a lot of people want to talk about it. And when I think of things like that, there's obviously a feeling towards the abuser that most people would have, right? That if I've been sexually abused, there's a feeling towards that abuser that is not very godly, you know? And it makes sense. I don't relate with that, but I know a lot of people who do. And when I hear their stories, I have that feeling towards those people. I don't even know them. And God says, listen, in the midst of all this anger and just this frustration, that person may never be served on this earth. That person may never have to come to justice or come to terms with those things. And there may be more people that this is going to be a habitual thing, and that who's the next girl? Or what's the next situation that's going to happen? Like, that guy needs to die. That guy needs to melt like slugs. Like, that guy, whatever, right? And God says, listen, I need you to vent that to me, not to the world. Because when you vent that to me, I have a solution. I have two solutions. The first solution is the cross. What's God's answer to my imprecation? Is the cross. Because God's ultimate goal is to not destroy people, but to change their hearts. And the first way, and the foremost way that God works and he wants us to work, is to try to change people's hearts. And that can be incredibly hard for people who have hurt you and who have wronged you. And that's why you give it to God. But I want to challenge some of you guys today that there's an area in your life, or there's people in your life that you have not forgiven, or that there's forgiveness needed. God is wanting you to maybe be that intercessor to show forgiveness for the cross. You have no idea how much power it shows to go to your abuser, or to go to your wrongdoer, to go to that person in your life that has wronged you and say, listen, I'm a steward of the Lord, and I'm here to forgive you for what's happened in your life. To change a person's heart. For me, as if I was a wrongdoer, to see somebody that would come to me and say, I forgive you for what you did wrong, that's the ultimate opportunity for hope. And for a lot of us, we're holding on to those grudges. And there are some cases where, like, you obviously don't get that opportunity to reconcile with people or to have that forgiveness had. But there are some people in your guys' immediate lives that we choose not to have that opportunity with. And God says, listen, if you call yourself my child or my son, you best believe that your role here on this earth is to forgive others, because I want to lead them to the cross before I want to lead them to hell. You may want them to go to hell, but that's not what I have in mind for my children. I want them all to have an opportunity for me. And we hope, and that's what God hopes, and it's not an easy feeling, it's not an easy thought process, but that's God's ultimate goal with our imprecation, with our anger, is to lead them to the cross. But ultimately, if people don't, it says in Romans 2:5 that God is storing up his wrath for the stubborn. And so the other side of this is his solution is either the cross or judgment. That all those things that went unanswered, all those things that went you know, unrepentant. All those things in this earth that people choose to do and not repent of and not turn towards God, they will have to give an answer to God one day for those things. And you will not get a say in what happens to that person because that's God's responsibility. And so, you know, we don't have a lot of contemporary songs that talk about impurgatory, you know, like being angry. You know, there's no like songs that I can Google like Christian songs that talk about melting people like slugs, you know, like, or, you know, Christian songs that, you know, talk about all these different things. But the Bible does talk a lot about armies. The Bible talks a lot about God has got himself an army and it's big. And when you think about getting vengeance on people, you don't think about one man. You think about an army. And if you look in the Old Testament, you see very clearly that God had armies that just destroyed and demolished towns and civilizations and people. Because God had some reckoning that needed to happen for people who were fighting against him. And so God used people, armies, to create judgment in his will. But God also says that he has his own army in heaven. He's got an angel army. And this army, we're currently not a part of. But he's got this angel army, and they're going to come in, and they're going to destroy, and they're going to have wrath, and they're going to do all these things that we wish we could do to people. But God says, listen, you need to vent to me, because there are some things that you want to do to people that aren't right. They're not biblical. They're not, even the stuff that David says, right? Like, whenever he says things like, I would rather them be like stillborns. The reason that we vent to God is so that he can have the discernment and the wisdom to deal with things according to his will. Not us putting things in our own hands and end up messing up and doing something even out of our own emotions. And so God says, give this to me, because there are certain things that, you know, tell me how you feel. Tell me how you truly feel. Be raw with me. And I'll come in and I'll do the things the way they need to. And so we sing this song called Angel Armies. And this song is an awesome song to help remind us that, listen, people are going to wrong us. People are going to put us in a bad spot, in a bad place. And it's going to be hard to have forgiveness. But we need to remember that when we give that to God, we have an angel army that fights for us. It says in the song that the angel armies, they're always by my side. That when you walk through this earth and you walk through life, that you can vent and give God all this anger and then realize that he's got a bad A army sitting side by side with you that's coming in to do all the work. And you don't have to live life in this state of mind that you just feel uneasy and you feel anxious and you feel weird and you feel like, oh, I got to do something about this. No, you don't. What you got to do is focus on making disciples, not trying to fix this world, because he's got an army that's going to do something to this world. Your job is to get as many people out of it before he comes in. And so we're going to sing the song Angel Armies. We're going to stand up and sing this song, and then we'll wrap it up with one last point.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me. Yours is the victory. shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful, and nothing formed against me shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. Before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Okay, lastly, God wants me to sing psalms of wisdom. And so, this is, you know, this is a great point to end on, a great psalm to think about. Because we don't want to grow up stupid, right? I mean, it's that simple, right? We don't want to grow up to know everything that we knew when we were 8, when we're 80. You know, we want to make sure that as we go through life, we gain wisdom, we gain intelligence, we learn things. And there's so many benefits to that, right? How many of you guys know how to change a spare tire? You know, honestly, put your hands down. How many of you guys don't know how to change a spare tire? There we go. All right. How many of you guys, let's see. How many of you guys know how to fix a patch? How many of you guys don't know how to fix a patch in drywall? Okay. How many of you guys don't know how to fix a leak in your plumbing? Right? If you did, you could save a lot of money, right? If you did, there's benefits to those kind of things, right? The more wisdom you have, the more blessing of a life you have, because those things that you learn and the wisdom that you have makes life better. How many of you guys wish you knew how to be in good relationships when you were in high school, right? How many of you guys didn't know how to be in positive relationships in high school, right? The wisdom would make things better, right? How many of you guys dated some shady girls or guys in high school, right? Wisdom and discernment would have made those situations better, right? In all these different areas in our lives, we can look at and be like, man, how many of you guys made mistakes with your first kid and you fixed it with your second, right? And you're like, I'm not doing that again. You're even sleeping habits or just different eating habits or just different things in general with your kids, you're like, oh, you turned out to be a monster. I'm going to fix that with my second one. Like, and there are some monsters out there, kids out there, trust me. But that's, the wisdom and discernment even in parenting. If I knew how to handle these things as a parent, maybe I wouldn't have the product of what I have now. And all these different things that God says, listen, those are all worldly opportunities with wisdom. So guess what I want you to get with me? Wisdom. I want you to have and ask and seek wisdom because it's what is going to make your life better. It says in Psalms 1:1-6, it says, God blesses those people who refuse evil advice and won't follow sinners or join in sneering at God. Instead, the law of the Lord makes them happy and they think about it day and night. They are like trees growing beside a stream, trees that produce fruit in season and always have leaves. These people succeed in everything they do. That isn't true of those who are evil because they're like straw blown by the wind. Sinners won't have an excuse on the day of judgment, and they won't have a place with the people of God. The Lord protects everyone who follows him, but the wicked follow a road that leads to ruin. You see, God wants me to sing psalms of wisdom because wisdom enables me to be blessed in this life and the next. It says in Proverbs 4:6-7, it says, cling to wisdom, she will protect you. Love her, she will guard you. Getting wisdom is the most important thing you can do. That's the most important thing we can do on this earth is to gain wisdom. And if that's the most important thing, then we should probably sing about it, you know, right? Like we should probably sing psalms and things about wisdom if it's the most important thing we can do on this earth. And the wisdom that we look for and the things that we seek for are not just scriptural wisdoms or religious wisdoms that make us just feel better about our relationship with God, but all these wisdoms that I talked about are wisdoms that give you a blessed life. You know, it says in Jeremiah 29, it talks about how God has these awesome plans, plans to give us a hope and a future. This idea that God wants us to live good lives here on earth. But that only happens through wisdom. That only happens through learning through the scriptures, learning the word of God, not just hearing it, but learning it and applying it in a way. What good would it be for you to watch YouTube videos of how to do plumbing or how to fix a tire or how to whatever and just know it but never experience it? You know, there's a difference between intelligence and wisdom because intelligence can be learned by anybody, but wisdom comes over time. You can have the biggest, baddest Bible degree in theology and know every single thing, but if you've never lived it, you have no wisdom towards your knowledge. And so many times we're like, oh, we need to read our Bibles. We need to know. And God's saying, you don't need to know. You need to know and live. Know and do. Gain experience. Learn from what I'm telling you to do. Don't just gain knowledge. Apply it to your life. And over time, that will cultivate wisdom, and you will become a person of influence for me. God needs men and women that are wise. This generation that's coming up needs wise moms and dads. It needs wise older brothers and sisters. It needs wise role models. Because when you look at the world and the children that are growing up in it, all you can think about is where are their roads heading? Think a lot about some of you guys that were brought out of those worlds. What's happening to those same kind of kids and those same kind of communities that you guys kind of were pulled out of? There's no wisdom in those communities. There's no wisdom in the world. God says the wisdom comes from my family, from my house. It comes from me. And then you need to take that out to the world and impart that onto other people. It says in Matthew 7:24-27, it says, those people who are listening to me, those people who hear what I say, that's the theology, that's the knowledge, and live according to my teachings. So it's not one without the other. Know what I say, hear what I say, and live according to it. You are like a wise man who built his house on a rock, on a firm foundation. When the storms hit, rain pounded down, and waters rose, levees broke, and winds beat all against the walls of that house, but the house did not fall because it was built upon a rock. Those of you who are listening, there's your knowledge, there's your Bible degree, there's your theology, but do not hear, there's your application. Even though you know it, see, a lot of people read this verse and they're like, it's people who know God's word and people who don't know God's word. That's not what he's saying here. He's saying everybody knows God's word, but just these people are applying it and these people aren't. You are like fools who build a house on sand. When the storm comes into the house, what will happen? The rain will fall, the waters will rise, the wind will blow, and his house will collapse with a great crash. You see, it's not difficult to read the Bible. There's so many produced in this world. Anybody can pick up a Bible and get a Bible degree. Anybody can pick up a Bible and just know it left and right. I know that there are atheists who don't believe in God that know scriptures better than I do. So it's not just knowing the word, but it's applying it to your life so that you can gain this wisdom that gives you a better life. It's learning how to use God's word in your life to say, oh man, I messed that up whenever I was younger. I'm not going to do that again because I've learned from my mistakes. Or this is the way that I think it needs to be handled because of my own thought process, my own heart, my own upbringing. But you, somebody who's older than me and has been spiritually matured and has went through the same situation and it turned out bad for you, you're telling me to not do it the way that I feel like I should do it? Because it's wise to not do it that way? You don't know how many times I talk with college kids and I'm like, hey man, I've been where you've been and I'm telling you, do not pursue this. Do not get yourself involved in this. Do not take that job. Do not date that girl. Do not, because this is what's going to happen because it has happened to me and hundreds of people I've seen this happen to in my time as campus ministry. And then what I see happen is they're like, man, but my heart is just telling me to do it. And then it happens. And then they come and talk to me and they're like, oh, man. It happened. You were right. You know? And I'm like, I'm not saying this stuff so I can be like, I told you so. I told you so. You know? I don't like saying I told you so. I like saying I'm glad you didn't have to go through that like I did. That's what I'd rather say to people. And that's what God's people rather say to people. And that's why God calls us to be bold with people and get into their lives and say, do not do that. Stay away from that. Because of our backgrounds and the way that we were raised and the things that happened to us, God is saying, get into their lives to make sure they don't do the same things that you did. Make sure they don't have the same situations happen to them. Make sure they don't find those lows like you had. You can help them not do that. But sitting silent and looking at their life going, they shouldn't be doing that. You feel me? They probably shouldn't be doing that. Well, go say something to them. No. I'm just saying they shouldn't be doing that. But I don't want to go talk to them about it. You know, like, that doesn't help anybody. But God's saying, sing about wisdom. Ask me for this wisdom. So what we're going to do here in a second is we're going to sing one last song. Well, we're going to sing two songs. So we're going to wrap it up for the day. But we're going to sing a song called Ancient Words. And this is an old hymnal too. And the song, it talks about, we want these ancient words, the scriptures to impart. We want them to be communicated. We want them to be known in our lives. And this song really just communicates, God, please just let these words communicate something in my life. Let them be able to do something for me and to me. And what we're going to do too is we're going to have you guys sit down while we sing this song. And there's a communication card in your guys' bulletins. I encourage you guys to pull that card out. Because this communication card, this is your opportunity to gain wisdom. To get a start and try to figure out what is it that God is wanting me to learn? What is it that God wants me to know? What is it in my life that I need to figure out or I need help with? And just communicate on that card. Indicate where you're at. If you have a marriage that's struggling, indicate on that card somewhere. You know, there's different boxes that have specific ministries that we help with. But there's also a prayer side where you can just write out what's going on in your life. Where is the areas of wisdom that you need? Is it like I said, is it a marriage that you're just struggling with? Is it parenting things that are going on? Is there abuse going on in your life? Is there an addiction that you're just kind of caught up in? Is there a sin that you just can't seem to get away from? But also any of these different things that we talked about today, is there something you're so angry about that you need to communicate to God and his people? Is there an area of your life that you just want to give praise to? Is there a sadness going on? Is there something going on in your life that you just feel you need to communicate? And use that card as an opportunity to show praise to God, to worship God. Because if this is on your heart and you're, God, I just want to give this to you, that's another way to show your worship. So we're going to sing the song Ancient Words, and that's going to give you guys some time to fill out that communication card. And then we're going to sing one last song. And then we'll be done for today. And like I said, guys, this is not a traditional crossing service. So if you're visiting with us today, I'm glad you guys came. I enjoyed the service. I enjoyed the way that this was kind of formatted. But this is not typically the way that we kind of do things here. So everything that we have done has been truth, you know. And so I encourage you guys to come back. There's a lot of people that tend to go out to lunch after church. And so for a lot of you new faces, like, just make sure you say hi to somebody, get connected. We didn't get that opening time today, but we would love for you guys to come out to lunch, to get connected, and to find ways that you guys can get involved with a lot of the things that we're trying to do here at the church. So I'm going to say a prayer. The worship team is going to come up, and we're going to finish the sermon out today. God, I just want to thank you so much for our worship team. God, it's just so cool to see that they can take these songs and just have such a powerful just way to communicate your words. And God, like I said, I'm not the greatest singer. I don't have the best tune to my voice or the talent. And so sometimes it hits my heart a lot deeper whenever there are people that are gifted like that, they can sing. And I know it's not about that, but God, it's such a blessing, and it's so cool to be able to have something like that here, Lord. But God, ultimately, like I said, worship is not about those things. It's about our hearts towards you and how we're trying to communicate with you. And God, through this whole series about why we sing to you, God, I pray we can remember that there are so many things in our lives that you brought us through, and so many things that we can use songs to communicate with you, Lord. So thank you so much for your son dying on the cross, for you giving us a church and a community to walk through life with, and the family that you've blessed us with. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.